So in the last two episodes, we looked at the difference between balanced and unbalanced contact microphones, and we saw how that difference affects the sound that you get. In this video, we're going to look at another categorization of contact mics, which is the difference between active and passive. Let's get started. So passive contact microphones encompass all of the mics that we've seen up to this point. They can be either balanced or unbalanced, but since their signal tends to be a little low, you typically need to turn up the volume on whatever you're recording with or your amplifier in order to get a nice loud signal from them. And the unfortunate side effect of that is that when you turn up the volume on a passive contact mic, you might also be turning up any noise or hiss that might be coming through the cable or from the preamp. Now, active contact mics, on the other hand, have electronics that are built directly into them, usually in the form of preamps or filters. And sometimes these preamps might be built into an external box that was made specifically for the signal that comes out of that contact microphone. Now, this amplification at the source means that you don't then need to turn up your preamp to get a nice loud signal from your contact microphone. Now we're going to get a little in the weeds here because I do want to take some time to explain terminology that you usually encounter when you're looking to either build or buy contact microphones. I'm going to keep all this very simple though, in an explain it like I'm five sort of level. While some of this might seem in-depth if you're just starting out, there are textbooks worth of content and studies written about each of these items that I'm going to just briefly explain. And I'm sure some audio engineers will want to let me know in the comments where I might go off the rails here, and I welcome that. But keep in mind that making sound art does not require you to know anything technical. So with that, let's get started. So let's start at the basics with signal level. Now this is just how strong an electrical signal is, and in our case, an audio signal. Now within the family of signal levels, you'll typically hear them referred to as mic level, instrument level, and line level. Now the most quiet of all these levels is mic level, and that's what comes out of a passive contact microphone. It doesn't mean that the signal is weak, but you do lose a lot of your low-end and mid-frequencies when you're using a passive microphone. Now a preamp will help out with getting a lot of those frequencies to come through, but we'll hit on that in a minute. Now instrument level's a little louder, and that's what will come out of a guitar or a bass, and sometimes different keyboards as well. Now line level is the highest of all audio signals, and it's what your audio gear will expect in order to record the signal of your contact microphone at the best quality possible. Now I've already mentioned preamps a number of times, but what are they? So preamp is short for preamplifier, and it's just that. A preamp takes a weaker signal and brings it up to a level that your gear can then use appropriately. So preamps can come in all kinds of different forms and in different types of equipment. They might be their own standalone unit, they might be built into an audio interface or a mixer. Preamps are also part of the circuitry within guitar amplifiers. And in our case here, preamps can also be built directly into contact microphones. Now gain simply refers to the amount you need to increase your volume in order to get it to a usable level. And like I mentioned earlier, increasing the gain on a passive microphone could also raise up noise or hiss that might be coming from the microphone or the preamp that you're using. And on the other side of gain, there's attenuation, also seen as pad on some audio equipment interfaces. And this is simply a way to turn your audio signal down by a few decibels in order for your preamp to not clip or distort the sound coming in. Now, while attenuation might be built directly into your audio interface, you can also buy attenuators as these little adapters as well. Noise floor and signal-to-noise ratio, sometimes abbreviated as SNR, refers to the static or hiss that's audible on any given audio equipment. Now, passive contact microphones, in our case, tend to have a much higher noise floor than active microphones. Now, this is by no means a scientific demonstration, but it's a great example of noise floor and the difference between passive and active microphones. So here on this Kalimba, I've attached a passive microphone here on the left and an active microphone on the right. And notice that in order to get the volume to match between the two microphones, I had to really crank up the gain on the passive microphone, which is input one. But now let's listen to a silent portion where I'm recording no playing at all, but listen to what we can hear when I crank up the gain on each channel. This is the active microphone's noise floor. And this is the passive microphone's noise floor. Now the SNR is the ratio between the sound of the Kalimba and the sound of the hiss. So this demonstration shows you that the signal-to-noise ratio on this active microphone in particular is much better than the passive. So let's talk about impedance. And you will usually hear impedance referred to as either input impedance or output impedance. Again, this is super simplified, so you can put the pitchforks down, you nerds. Now you can think of input impedance as the pull that a device has on a signal, or how much it resists the signal that's coming into it. And think of output impedance as the push that a device gives to a signal, or how easily that the signal can flow out of it.
A lot of times you see high impedance and low impedance abbreviated to either high Z or low Z. Now, high impedance microphones resist sending their signal to low impedance inputs, and this affects tone and requires you to turn up gain quite a bit more on the preamp side. Now, low impedance or low Z signals, which are found in our case in active contact microphones, send their signal much more effectively to low impedance inputs. And low impedance signal also works really well for long cable runs. Now, sometimes when you're researching contact microphones or impedance in general, you'll see ratings like 250 to 50,000 ohms on the specs. Now, an ohm is a unit of measurement that measures resistance. And knowing that rating will help you match your contact microphone or instrument to the proper preamp setting. Now, one area of impedance is impedance matching. You want to make sure that your output impedance and your input impedance are compatible. Now, it's not always required to match your output and input impedance 100%, but the rule of thumb here is that you want your output impedance of your contact microphone to be lower than the impedance on your preamp. Now, there are transformers like this one here that will turn your low impedance signal into a high impedance signal. And you'd use something like this if you want to safely connect a low impedance output into a high impedance instrument input, like an effect pedal or a guitar amplifier. And this converts that low impedance signal to a high impedance signal without losing any of the tone or quality. On the opposite side, something like this DI box will take a high impedance signal and convert it to a low impedance signal, also effectively turning an unbalanced signal into a balanced signal. And something like this will help your signal from a passive, unbalanced contact microphone stay nice and strong even if you're running through long cables. Filtering is another term that you'll see when you're researching active contact microphones, and a lot of active microphones will have these built into their circuitry. Now, filtering comes in all kinds of different forms, but the two basic terms that you'll find are high-pass filters and low-pass filters. Now, a high-pass filter allows the high end of a signal to pass through freely while it cuts off a certain amount of your low end from the signal. So this might be helpful to keep any kind of rumbling out of a signal. Low-pass filters allow everything in the low end to pass through while cutting off a certain amount of the high frequencies. And that will do exactly what you'd expect. It might take off some of the shrill sounds from your contact microphone's output. Now, while active microphones will have these bits of electronics built into them, those bits of electronics do require power to work properly. And that's where phantom power comes into play. Now, if you have audio equipment that you're using that has phantom power on it, it'll typically let you turn that on or off with a button that's labeled 48V. And when this option is turned on, your audio interface is then going to send enough power through your cable to make the electronic components in your active microphone work. Now, in the last episode, we talked about cable length, and that's a good term to keep in mind when you're considering your contact microphones and how you use them, as well as balanced versus unbalanced audio signals. So that's as deep in the weeds as we are going to go here. And trust me, the weeds go miles beyond where we're at. Now let me show you some of the active contact microphones that I use for my own sound experiments. So this contact microphone's by a company called Zeppelin Design Labs, called the Cortado, and this is the Mark III. They've had a few versions before this, but this is their latest model. This is a mic element that then is permanently attached to this preamp module. If you'd like to stick it to something, you can use something like sticky putty, which I use quite a bit. And another neat thing about this model is there are some switches on the back that you can use for attenuation and also for bass boosting. So that's a unique feature to this specific contact microphone. This is a contact microphone by the company called Metal Marshmallow. With this microphone, the preamp is built directly into the little head module here, and he's actually built a volume attenuation dial directly onto the contact module. It's a very sensitive microphone, so having this control is good for very quiet sources or very loud sources. So I include this microphone with my active contact microphones, even though the electronics inside don't work exactly like a piezo element. You still use this in a very similar fashion. And this is by a company called Wham Electronics, and this is called their low phone. It's specifically to get lower frequencies from items that you attach it to. It's got a cable that comes separate, and I made this little wraparound case for it. And one of the features that I really like about this guy is that the tips can be changed. So this is a magnet, which will stick this to metal, obviously, but it also comes with a little suction cup holder that you can twist in there, as well as this little spike. And with this little spike attachment, you can push this into the ground or anything else that might be making noise and can be pierced. And this one is also from Wham Electronics. Even with this very thin profile, they've got their preamp built into it. And finally, this guy is from a company called Soniphorm. So this is an active magnetic contact microphone. And Ed Devane is the, I like to call him an artist, because what he makes with electronics are art. So there is a magnet in this, which makes it really handy to be able to stick to metal objects. I've written this number one on there because I have two of these. And I just happened to grab the first one first.
Now, links to all of these contact microphones are available on the contact microphone buying guide that I have on Patreon. And beyond just links to all of these microphones, I also have links to all the passive contact microphones I use, all of the materials I use to build my own, and all kinds of other accessories that you might want to consider if you're jumping into the world of contact microphones yourself. Now again, one thing that all of these contact microphones have in common is that they have their own preamplifier that is built specifically for their use case. But if you're comfortable with electronics, you can actually build your own contact microphone preamp. There are a ton of online tutorials and blog posts and schematics that will help you build one of these yourself. And some manufacturers, like Metal Marshmallow for instance, will make kits that you can buy so that you don't have to source all the parts yourself. And again, I link to this in the contact microphone buying guide that's on my Patreon. So between episodes 1, 2, and now this one, you have a very strong foundation to use to start building, buying, and using your contact microphones. Balanced, unbalanced, passive, active, it all comes down to your needs and what equipment you have on hand. But the fun part, for me, comes down to actually using them. And that's what I'm going to be showing in the next episode, where I take you into the field and show you some of the studio techniques I use for actually using these contact microphones I've been showing you. I'll see you there.